Well, I'm very excited. We're here with Corey McAbee today. Did I say it right?
That was perfect.
Okay, great. I'm known for mispronouncing names sometimes on purpose for fun, sometimes because I'm a fool. But Corey McAbee from, the American Astronauts, where I first knew you from. And then, of course, Stingray Sam. There we go. Let's get a wide shot here so everybody can see this. Is in studio today for a special broadcast, a fun time, good show.
Yay!
On Deep Ellum on Air from One Eye Joe Media. Okay, now that I got those out of there, that's all I have to do. So, Mr. McAbee, it's fantastic. Thank you for coming in today. This is a real treat.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Been a fan for years now, and when my producer was like, I think there's a chance Corey McAbee may come on the show, I was like, you get him or death. So he came through, and I'm releasing him from his bonds today.
And he lives another day.
He lives another day. So we're going to cut this one pretty short for the cold open. I don't think there's any real reason to drag this one out. And, oh my gosh, there's another camera in here today, too. So we're going to just run the theme song and then just get right to it. Here we go. All right, and we're back with Corey McAbee in studio today. Also, Brian Raylander of renowned fame, just general fame. He's pretty good at it.
I'm world famous.
Well, let's say you might enjoy having a mic on. There
Turn
you go.
Turn my mic on. I got things to say.
And say them. Now everybody's really dying to hear this.
Well, now my mind has gone blank.
Yes, usual. Okay, so today, Corey, what can we expect? You've got a talk you're giving tonight over at the Texas Theater at 8 p.m.
Yeah, actually, I'm going to be performing music and also giving a talk afterwards. The performance is called the Small Star Seminar. And right now I'm on tour. I've been touring for several weeks. Started in Colorado, did a tour of Colorado, then went to Iceland, played at the Reykjavik.
Wow, okay.
I know. It's a nice place.
A jump.
It's an ice place.
That was beautiful. And then came back, played at the New York Film Festival, and then began in Seattle and made my way down the coast. And it's a part of a global collaborative feature film project. So different people have been picking me up and driving me from point A to point B because I have no money and I don't know how to drive. I've been treated very well by some wonderful people all along the way, and different people show up and film and contribute their footage to this project and doing different people doing graphics.
And what
graphics.
Is the idea for the end result for the project?
The end result will be a feature film called Small Star Seminar, and it's, again, a global collaborative piece. And the after it pays its bills and pays its taxes, the money that the film makes will be given to charity, Doctors Without Borders.
So, oh, fantastic.
Yeah, but that's because we can't afford to pay everybody anyway. So, you know, if it makes any money, we'll give it to some
there
nice people.
There you go. That makes it seem like you're doing the right thing instead of paying people for their hard work. I like it.
We'd be right.
That's how I run this studio.
We'd have 2,000 checks for 50 cents each to be accountable for at the end of the year had we done it any other way.
So I want to talk, before we kind of know where you're going now, I'd like to go back and start at kind of at the beginning. How did you first get into, because I actually own a copy of the hand-drawn art you did for the very first piece that I can think of. It was the Billy Nayer show. Was that what it was called, about the kissing a dog on the mouth?
Oh, yeah. That was my first film. I started a band at the same time as starting that animated piece, and the animated piece had a fictitious name, Billy Nayer, so I called the band the Billy Nayer Show, and played in the Billy Nayer Show for about 24 years, I guess, were together.
And so what year was this when you kind of kicked it off?
In the late 80s, and then the Billy Nayer Show ended in 2011. It was a lot of fun. There was probably over 50 different musicians came and went throughout the years.
Yeah, because I saw, there'd be a lot of people rotating through that I would see would change between the albums.
Yeah,
That was fascinating.
And it was always me and the drummer, Bobby Lurie.
Right, he was the producer on a lot of that, and I always thought that was kind of cool. Because my dad, who knew who Bobby Lurie was.
Knew his father, probably.
Yeah, maybe that's what it was. Yeah. And so that was kind of neat. So you started with the Billy Nayer Show doing the hand-drawn art, and you went to the next one up there, was it Ketchup Mustard Man? Or?
There was a little Pixel Vision piece when Pixel Vision cameras were first introduced to the market. They were only out for a little
while. Ladies and gentlemen, Matt, our producer, is standing awkwardly off camera waiting to come in.
Come on in.
So let's go ahead and just draw attention to it since he...
We don't have any canned...
Laughter?
Just applause.
No, we used to actually keep a can of clams around here for a joke, but that I don't know what happened to those.
Somebody found it. One.
They were in a what's in the box for like four times, and nobody ever guessed clams. So, but I'm sorry.
Yeah.
After that rude interruption, please continue.
No, it was a welcome interruption. Thank you. So what was I talking about then?
Ketchup Mustard Man, you said, was something in between the pixels.
Yeah, it was called The Man on the Moon. And, it was the first time that it was sort of a confessional sort of film. I hadn't seen those before, but now they're like a regular feature.
And this is you as a person on the moon kind of transmitting back to Earth. And this is where the famous or infamous Christmas song that I now force everyone to listen to at Christmas.
Yeah.
And what's the title of that one? I can sing it in my head, but I can't remember the title.
Sort of a makeshift version of Must Be Santa. Is a much older song. Bob Dylan put out a Christmas record with a really sort of a almost Pogues version of Must Be Santa on it.
That's pretty
slamming. Yeah, it'll get the kids bouncing off the walls.
And those kids love their bouncing off walls. That's what they do.
It's that rock and roll music that the kids today love so much.
The hula hoops and the bouncing off the walls. They got it down. So, and then you catch up Mustard Man, which is a little more of a, I don't know how to even kind of describe that one. It was short stories almost mixed with live performance.
Right. It was originally a live piece, the whole thing was. And the film was supposed to be a live piece. Look like the live piece and be built from that. But most of the footage got destroyed, so we did the stuff with me without the costume. Narration piece and put together a different version.
Okay. And what's one of your favorite pieces that you've done? Do you have a favorite?
Actually,
are they
right
all
now,
your babies?
I hope this doesn't sound corny, but right now it's this new album, and the reason it came about so quickly, you know, the last album, which you were talking about, the Billy Nayer Show or BNS Presents the Billy Nayer Show. I love that record, and it took 5 years to make. This record took 2 months to make, from conception to writing it to recording it in my apartment.
Those you gotta love, though, the ones that just come out so easy.
It's as if I found it in a box with my name on it, and it's like, this is your record. So it's very exciting, and I'm still learning.
And literally, he was hanging out at Bobby's house, and he was like, what's this box under Bobby's bed? I'll call it mine.
it was done on a Zoom mic. And with some rough instruments that I had around the house, and a outdated version of GarageBand, a festival in Poland contacted me and said, "Can you come and perform?" And I said, "Sure." And they said, "Well, what are you doing? Is your band together?" I'm like, "No, we haven't been together for a few years." And they said, "What about Captain Ahab's Motorcycle Club, which this is now a part of?" And I said, "No, that's it," which is the name of the global collaborative.
Okay, that's what I was going to ask for a little clarification on that. I was a little unclear on that.
Yeah, so that's a global collaborative I began in 2012.
I think we have a website for that up as well.
Yeah, CaptainAhabsMotorcycleClub.com. Or if you go to my thing, my page, CoreyMcAbee.net, it's net. There's a .com out there that you can visit too, but CoreyMcAbee.net is the active living website at the moment. But you can... find out about all this stuff and join the collaborative and be a member and a contributor and a participant in this project. But anyway, so they asked if I could do this live performance in Poland, and I said, they wanted 70 minutes. So I had a couple of months, and I said, let me put together something for you. And this, it turned out to be my favorite record.
Well, that's okay. I can't say anything better about that. Yeah. And we do have a couple of tracks. Do you mind if we...
Please,
yeah,
yes,
let's see
yes.
what we got here. We've got a song by Bob Dylan about Santa Claus. Is that you? Okay. Let's see. I have I Was Once Like You and Good Enough.
Yeah, and those are the audio tracks. We also have the...
Oh, we do. That's right. We have the music video for one of those.
The music video, I put that up in English and Polish, and it has since been translated into... Now we have it in 16 different languages, translated by collaborators and contributors around the world.
See, that's just amazing to me. I can't get these guys to do anything, and you have people for free translating things. And oh, let me, Matt, go ahead with your
microphone. I showed up today.
You got me Corey McAbee. So you're done for the year. You don't have to do anything else. I'm very
nap
excited.
Time.
We have you showing up on film.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. My grand entrance.
So I'm going to play a Small Star Corporation here. This is the correct one.
That's the English mm-hmm. version, yeah.
Okay, great. Let's all take a
or you can translate
a
it
gander
from
at this. I will be translating on the fly as we watch this.
There goes the night as you leave your dreams behind you. Into the light where the night can never find you. The night has left you many times before, but it keeps coming back for more. There goes the light like a dying ember into the night.
Fantastic. I really, really enjoyed that.
Thank you.
Corey, every song gets better.
Thank you.
This is fantastic.
I was hoping somebody would say that.
One of the things I like about you is you seem so happy to be performing. In everything you do, there's always this like slight smile where you're like, yeah, I get to do this. And you always just look pleasantly delighted at everything you get to do with your life.
Well, the performances that I'm doing now, it's nice. I get to hold a mic again and move around. You know, playing an auto harp, I loved playing it, but it was very restrictive. You know, you had to stand still and couldn't move, otherwise you'd move your lose your place on your microphone. Right. And, you know, it's after a while, it was like doing your taxes up there, you know, moving your fingers and holding still. But this, I get to jump around. I get to have fun. I get to run up and down stairs if there are some. I get to enjoy myself, actually.
Well, really now, most people at home, myself. Because he's off camera, you have a 7'4", very strong bodyguard who off camera is holding a gun at me, and he wanted me to reiterate that you're doing a live musical performance tonight.
It's a musical performance tonight.
Jared, is that okay? Was that good? Okay, perfect. So that's fantastic. He must eat a lot of food. You've got to spend most of your money on it.
Surprisingly, he doesn't.
Really? Fantastic.
Oh, he's a vegan.
Yeah.
He's very lean, that man. So, but no, it's a musical performance in addition to speaking a little bit as well. And so this is the behind the screen at the Texas Theater. If you haven't been, it's where they lower the screen to the ground and you're actually backstage with the performer or artist. And it's a very small area. It's almost like a black box, but you're very up close with the people you see performing. It's one of my favorite places to go. Matt and I were there just recently for the Dallas Comedy House and Paul Varghese, and it's just a blast. So I think you're going to have a fun time.
I think I'm going to love it. Just everything you said sounds right up my alley.
Now, we want to talk a little bit, I'm messing up the name here, it was the Deep?
Deep Astronomy,
Deep Astronomy, and this is something new that is very real, and it's very immersive, but we want to talk about this a little bit.
Well, that's what a lot of this project is about. That song, Small Star Corporation, is it's pertains to deep astronomy. The Small Star Corporation is working with newly crafted scientists to explore something far-reaching by not reaching far at all, you see. Right. And what happened was a few years ago I fainted, and when I did, I saw what I identified as stars, and since then I've been able to see them in other people. And I talked to a scientist, established scientist, about helping me in exploring this new field, and none of them were interested. So I talked to some chemists as well, and they weren't interested. And the closest thing I knew to a chemist who might be interested was this bartender in San Jose, who was actually wonderful at mixing.
They deal with solutions a lot.
He did, and he could also make people pass out really well.
This guy really is the bridge between what you need here.
He was, and so I contacted him. His name is Ferguson, and asked him if he would help. And he got really behind the project, but since then he's kind of gone a little bit renegade, and he's been doing his own experiments, which have been taking a lot of toll on his health, and writing his own book about the subject. But it's a little different than what I'm working on, but we stay in contact.
Well, you know, if there's anything we could do to help here, maybe from a tiny web show nobody watches, maybe we could help out on that.
Yeah, well, you know, you are invited.
All
this
right.
This is it's an ongoing thing, and it's a growing thing. So I also, I don't know, you could see it on my, I got a wonderful letter from a woman at NASA, one of the scientists there who saw this video and wrote me this very beautiful, poetic response to the song. So there are some actual, you know,
people are gonna start glomming on as it gets
it's
bigger
working.
And bigger.
It is working.
Just so, like a planet comes together, stuff starts to aggregate. It's gonna get bigger and bigger.
Yeah, and we talk about that sometimes in between songs at the performances. Toward the end, sometimes we have a conversation about deep astronomy as a group, and I answer questions and. It's actually a really enjoyable process, and it's also helping me find out what this project is.
Very cool. Now, from that, I want to switch to and tell you the story of how Brian and I, and apparently we disagree on this.
We do disagree.
About how we first got introduced to you. It was after, it was after a party where a friend of ours ran through a glass door.
It happened way before that.
Did it?
Was it open?
Okay. You're absolutely right. This was at the apartment.
This is at the apartment.
Because this was right before Stingray Sam came out when we first found out about you.
Correct. A buddy of mine, a mutual friend of ours.
Who was supposed to be here today, but apparently
to today as well.
Slept through, so he's going to feel really, really bad about this later.
So he gave me a copy of The American Astronaut, and he's like, just when you have time, watch it, let me know what you think.
And that's all he told me. So it sat on my DVD shelf for about 2 months, and he would be like, have you watched it yet? I'm like, not yet. He's like, watch it. I'm like, okay. So one night, Dell and I were hanging out, and we were like, okay, we're finally going to sit down. We're going to watch this, and we're going to...
Like, you know, we'll give it 20 minutes. We'll see if we like it or not. We'll see where it goes.
And I think it was... right about the time that the Hey Boy yes. song started, like we both were just looking at each other like, what in the world are we watching?
In a good way. We were very much like, I'm enjoying this. I love it. I have no idea what I got involved in.
And then I think right about the time that the dance contest started, we were like, I can't wait for this to end so we can watch it again.
Yeah, that's right. We actually were wanting to go back and start it. I actually watched it the next night again as well. Did we watch that one together?
Probably.
It was. And then everybody we've known, I've been like, you have to see this American Astronaut. This is one of the best American films
ever. We would
ever
pretty much Shanghai anybody that came to the apartment, sit him down and be like, you need to watch this
right now. Yeah, because I'm a big fan of musicals. I'm a fan of old sci-fis, like the old Twilight Zone and Outer Limits. So to see like those kind of sets mixed with very abstract, almost alt-rock type music and choreographed numbers was just like, that was my thing right there. That was just fantastic. And I wanted to play the Hey Boy for the people... at home to get a sense of this is what we were into 10 minutes into the film. I think this one happens. Your character, what was the
Samuel Curtis?
Samuel Curtis has landed on Ceres, and there's a little bar there, and you're meeting with the Blueberry Pirate.
Yeah,
is that right?
Okay. Interplanetary movie.
Yes, that's right.
Larry,
and you're going to go to the restroom, which I love that it's not futuristic toilets and stuff at all. This is a dingy bar.
They even make a point of saying it's a real toilet, right. So you have to
be careful. That's yeah. right. So this is Hey Boy off the American Astronaut, and this just warms my heart that this is a thing.
Hey boy, I got a message for you about a thing called love and the stars above and a little white dog since pushed her to shove to fist to cuffs. Things really got rough, but enough's enough. Hey boy, I heard it from a friend about you, about your hatred when you're lying in your bed. From the things you said, and you wish you were dead because you're separated from the thing called love and the stars above. And a little white dove sits pushed her to shove, the fist to cuffs. Things really got rough, but enough's enough.
Okay, watching Samuel Curtis sitting on the toilet, like, every now and then he's like looking through the cracks. Like, what is going through his mind?
Now this is where it gets going. They're actually starting to dance and clap. This is what they're doing. They are fully committed to this. Really?
Hey boy.
Now this rolls into what you're doing now, but you look at performances like that, and somebody that you said one take. Okay, so that guy had to believe in you so much to be able to do that dance and commit to it that way. And now you've got a community of people that are working with you on the new project. What is that? How are you able to, when so many people complain about, oh, well, the crowdsourcing and doing things with other people, whereas you embrace it, like that is part of what you do.
Yeah, more so now than before. With the Billionaire Show, we were very kind of insulated because some of the people were, you know, much more private and going out and being working with people was a little bit, I guess, intimidating for some of the people we worked with.
Right.
And so when the Billionaire Show quit, I wanted to go the exact opposite direction and open it up to all the people who've said, you know, come stay at my house, we'll make you dinner, we'll, you know, I'd love to help you. And one of the first things that happened when I decided to do this was just right before I decided to do Captain Ahab's Motorcycle Club, which is the collaborative,
right.
This gentleman, Jonathan Ashley, sent me an email and said, I'm an illustrator. I'd love to contribute to anything you're working on. I'm like, well, perfect timing. This is a collaborative. So he did actually, maybe you could pull it up. If you go to CaptainAhabsMotorcycleClub.com and look at related images, there's a wonderful image there that Jonathan Ashley first did of... he said, well, what should... I said, we need a main image. And he said, what should it look like? And I said, cross between Moby Dick and The Wild One.
Okay, and which part is it under here?
All right.
We've got the website pulled up for the people to see.
That is a perfect mix.
Yeah, it's a... let's see. Daryl, can you point to that one for him? Daryl's helping produce this this feature film that we're making right now.
Go ahead.
Yeah, she'll grab a hold of that mouse. She's not afraid of your mouse.
Oops.
Oh, and she broke it. We're all
down. There you go. Related artwork.
Oh, all right.
Which one is it, Corey?
It's the one with all the guys on the motorcycles driving with the harpoons.
Nice.
There you go. That's nice. That was the first image that was created by Jonathan Ashley in New York.
And can we get this on a t-shirt?
You know, if you just kind of press yourself up against the screen, maybe. we haven't made any t-shirts yet.
Oh, man, I would wear that for sure. That's a great picture.
Well, there's also a lot of chapter patches. We had over 60 illustrators have contributed artwork for this. And the first collection was the chapter patch collection for Captain Ahab's Motorcycle Club. And it was a local people, you know, doing their own interpretations of what a chapter patch would be.
Right.
Since then... one of the things which made me think about using the Small Star Seminar as a topic for this film was people started making artwork for it. And so now all the artwork is being geared towards deep astronomy, the Small Star Seminar. Also, some people have sent me some sketches for propaganda posters about the FC. The FC are the fact checkers.
Right.
And we are the truth seekers. They are the fact checkers. And, you know, there are... frighten people. They deconstruct what they can't imagine, and that's not how we roll, is it, gentlemen?
Not at all. Not at all.
Sir. I don't think as an artist you can only go with what's presented right in front of you. You gotta see there's a little more behind that.
Yeah. Look for the truths, you know, and don't let people break them down by you know, factagonizing them.
It's the Factagrian theorem. Yeah, I believe is the... There we go. Factagrian. Perfect. Trademarked Fun Time Good Show. We've restricted that.
I said it first, though.
You didn't call the trademark, Corey. Sorry about that.
You can't call a trademark out of something that comes out of somebody
like
else's mouth.
Yeah. Legalese over here. Law talk.
You know, you've got the judge's table over there, but that's nice.
All these pill bugs. Don't mind me. let's see here. What, Brian, what's... you've got to have some questions, right? We've waited years to meet Mr. McAbee here.
How long did it take you and, was it Krudgy? Who's in Stingray Sam?
Oh, the handshake.
I like to call him Krudgy.
The handshake.
Krugy.
Okay.
Krugy.
See, again, nobody's ever...
no, you could trademark Krudgy.
That's all yours.
A new character now.
we're kind of on a Corey McAbee island here in Dallas. Like, Dell and our other friend Aaron are the only people I know in the area that have really latched on to your
work. Insane to me, because I can see, like, in LA and New York and larger cities, this is going to be eaten up immediately. You're just so wildly artistic and in so many different fields. And in Texas, unfortunately, if it's not about rock or a little bit of country, then sometimes we have
or tacos.
Trouble. Or tacos. That's true. We are big about our tacos.
You know, I like all three. This might be the place for me.
But yes, how did the handshake come about?
The handshake, I wrote that into the script. I said, then they shake hands for 2 minutes. And I was just those words, I was like, this is going to be great.
Right.
And then when I got on set, I was like, oh, this might not be so good. You know? So I started working with Krugy, actually before we got on set, when we started rehearsing, just kept adding on to it and adding on to it. You know, and then we'd get good at it, and we're like, all right, let's add on another couple moves. And just developed it to where we got to. And when we'd see each other, it was like a duel. You know, it'd be like, hey, what's going on? And you'd put up your hand and be like, all right. And you just go for it.
We've seriously debated possibly learning that just so we can do it in front of other people and weird them out in real life. And I bet it's just got to be the best.
It absolutely works. And the response that the go-go dancers,
that is
the
great.
Liberty Chew Chewing Tobacco Girls give is what you will get.
And that was, and see, I have that one up too, because for me, Welcome to Mars is, I call it one of the most punk rock songs I'd ever heard. It sounded, it was dirty, it was nasty, it was short, it was sweet, and it was about Mars. So it's pretty much nothing I didn't like about that one. And that's got to be up there with one of my favorites that you've done. What's your kind of process for songwriting? I mean, how do you come up with something like that? Obviously, this was a little themed around Stingray Sam.
Yeah, that was, I just feel like I get lucky sometimes, basically. That's my process. I get lucky sometimes. And sometimes I'll come up with a really good song in the shower, and by the time I get out of the shower, I'll be like, ah, it wasn't meant to be. Mm-hmm. Can't remember it. But I actually do a lot of writing in the shower because there's a lot of hot water hitting me in the head, I guess. I don't know.
The acoustics are really good in there.
Yeah, the acoustics are good, and nobody's bothering me, and, you know.
Yeah.
Standing there,
written a few good songs myself in the shower.
Yeah,
not too bad.
You're looking down. You got feet like Nosferatu, and you're like, okay, man, this is good.
So, so the song "The Girl with the Vagina Made of Glass,"
yeah,
which is another fantastic song. But that was on an album previous to being in The American Astronaut, wasn't on a Brigadoon or something.
Was
like
it on
that?
Brigadoon?
It may have been the one before that.
I don't know. I
but I remember seeing that and going, whoa, that was like, I'd heard that song somewhere before I saw it in the movie. And when the movie came, I was like, wait a second.
Well, some of the songs inspire scenes. And a lot of the songs are inspired by the script. You know, they're written for the script. But every now and then I'll be writing and I'll think, you know, this, I like this song and it'll apply really well to this situation. And so I just, you know, appropriate my own work in from one project into the next.
If you're going to steal somebody, steal from yourself.
That's what I do. I do it all the time. That's why I'm so broke.
Keep suing yourself.
Yeah. Like, so, haha, it's mine. Whoa, it's nothing.
And how is... Well, first of all, I want to talk about the cinematography for both Stingray Sam and American Astronaut, because it has that classic camera on a tripod, very much like the old, Outer Limits. Where did you kind of draw from cinematically to kind of define the tones of those?
Well, I worked with two really good DPs on both of those films. The American Astronaut was with Mott Hupfel.
Okay.
And we shot that on 35mm. And, it was just a classic setup. Lights so bright you can barely stand them.
Right.
And, big dollies to move giant cameras around with a bunch of stuff in it. By the way, the American Astronaut's now in the permanent collection at the Library of Congress.
Wow. Are you serious?
Yes. That's awesome.
That's
congrats.
Wow,
thank
absolutely.
You.
I mean, it deserves it 100%.
It worked really well. The person who was housing them was cleaning out his...
Slipped it in there when no one was looking?
No, he was cleaning out his studio, and he goes, I don't have space for these. Somebody's going to take them, or else I can't keep them. I'm going to have to chuck them or something. And I said, no, I'll keep them. And there are these big, pointy, metal, dented cans in my office, you know, for like a year. And I knew one was a print, and I thought the other was a negative. And so a guy from the Library of Congress contacted me and said, you know, if you have any relics, any set pieces or anything from the American Astronaut, we'd love to have them as part of our collection. And I said, yeah, I got the print here, I got the negative here, you can have it, you know, I got that. There's nothing I can do with them, you know.
Well, thanks for sending me one.
Yeah.
Would have been up on my shelf for sure.
Yeah, well, my shelves couldn't hold them. They weigh a ton. And so we drove out from Virginia, and we went to this diner, and we got pastrami sandwiches and vanilla egg creams, and had a very nice lunch. And then he packed
tell me
them up
more about
left.
The meal. I understand the Library of Congress thing. Tell me more about this meal and pastrami sandwich you had.
Well, wait, it was.
I haven't had lunch today.
It was in Queens, New York, where they.
Well, I bet they have a good pastrami.
They make good egg creams, vanilla egg creams. I didn't know what that was when I was a kid, but
I don't know what that is.
I still don't
let's
know what that is.
Let's hear a little more about this.
It's like soda water and vanilla with some milk in it, and they whip it up just right, and. It's not bad.
Sounds pretty tasty.
That's
all right,
what we
somewhere
had.
Somewhere up there, we're going to have to do that.
I think we split a second one or something. Two straws, you know.
Tell me a little bit about Crazy and Thief.
Crazy and Thief, there was a point where I was, you know, I'd written a few other screenplays, and I was at a point where I thought, I don't know if I'm ever going to be able to make another film, you know. And if I do, what would the last film I ever make be? And I came up with Crazy and Thief. And it's... basically meant to be like, bless you, it's meant to be like a love letter, you know, that it's for free. You can find it on Vimeo. It's an hour long, or a little under an hour, like 55 minutes, I think. And I wrote it as a, it's a screenplay, but I threw a lot of caution to the wind when I cast a two-year-old as the lead actor.
That's right.
I cast my son, Johnny, when he was two, and my daughter, Willow, when she was seven. And went out to make this film as organically as possible. And Scott Miller, who shot Stingray Sam, was the DP on that. And we went out and made this very organic film. It's the storyline is more in keeping with like an early Sesame Street episode than a regular narrative.
Okay.
But there is a narrative in there. It's very lightly woven through the piece. The music in it was the last thing that the Billy Nair Show did. It was a duet piece with me and Bobby Lurie. I was on electric auto harp. We brought in some overdubs here and there, but mostly it's pretty pure. It's won a few awards because it is about 55 minutes. I went out and filled in the rest of the time slot doing Captain Ahab's Motorcycle Club performances.
Yeah, and it's got a good 7.3, so it's out of 10. On IMDb, so I mean, it's definitely up there. People are liking it.
Those cranks online,
yeah, yeah.
The fact checkers, right here. Here's me.
No, but it's true though what you say. So you're still in the truth seeker
okay,
corner.
Yeah. I can get that. I do want to play the since we're talking about Stingray Sam and it was the same DP. I do want to play the trailer for Stingray Sam.
Oh,
just
yeah,
give
cool.
people an idea of what it looks like. And here we go with that.
Chewing Tobacco presents... screens of all sizes.
It was great because we were able to you released it a little bit of time. Brian actually went out of town, so we were forced to watch three episodes, wait a while, and then watch them again. So we got to watch it in a somewhat serial fashion.
DVD.
Yeah,
the internet.
I held off. I was like, I will. Whoa, there it goes again. First of all, Liberty Choo Choo and Tobacco. I'll never forget that until the day I die because it sponsors everything in my head now.
Yeah.
But what was that? There was a thing I was going to say, and now I forgot, Brian. What was it?
We were talking about, just a second ago, we were talking about the Marfa, Texas?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, you just asked how Austin was. Oh, just played at the Alamo Draft House two nights ago in Austin. And the night before, I got to perform at the Marfa Film Festival in Marfa, Texas. And there's a projected element. There's visuals. To the Small Star Seminar musical performance. And so I got to perform in a drive-in out in the middle of nowhere that was so put cool. together by the Alamo Draft House, their big, you know, mobile projector right. unit. And got to sing out there under the stars nice. And do this big performance. And a gentleman showed up from Russia who had a drone camera, so he filmed
oh,
it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And
we got one ourselves. We've been playing around with a new drone, but they're pretty fine.
It'd be nice to have it. You should have it in here while you're doing your show.
We could have the mini one in here.
Yeah. I was like running the board and the camera and flying a drone at the same time.
Watch the ceiling fan.
We got it. Behind all of that.
Hey, let Jared, the bodyguard, run the drone.
Yeah, right. He's got nothing.
Come on, Jared.
Yeah. Relax, dude.
I know that guy's buff, and he doesn't even work out. It's just hatred.
Natural.
When you said he eats very little, we were talking about this off the air, he only eats hay.
You
it's
know,
a very odd thing.
Is that it's what he says. I've never seen him eat. I'm like, what do you eat? And, you know, yeah.
Great.
Who are some of the influences that you have? I mean, you cover a wide variety of things. You had the graphic novel that you did before. Who are some of the artists that you look at, you know, and go...
In the past, the reason I got into making musicals is I became an instant fan of Dennis Potter the moment I was introduced to his work. He did the Singing Detective series, which is amazing, an amazing masterpiece.
If you can Singing Detective
Series. The Singing Detective series. He did that. I was introduced to him by... They try to make feature films out of his work. The only time I think it was successful was Pennies from Heaven with Steve Martin.
I love Pennies from Heaven. Okay.
Yeah, amazing film. That's the first thing I saw. Then I immediately saw this Singing Detective series and realized there was this whole world going on that I didn't know about. If you have a chance, sometime you can... his last interview, he was dying of cancer, and he knew he had about 3 weeks to live, and he was writing this 7-hour miniseries, and he thought, I don't want this to be my last miniseries. So he wrote a simultaneous one called Cold Lazarus about a guy who it's about the star of the first miniseries he was writing. He dies and they cut off his head and they freeze it, and 2,000 years in the future they thaw him out and they're able to broadcast his memories and his thoughts, and he becomes like the property of, you know, the networks, which are the government.
This sounds like every Tyler Perry movie I've ever seen.
And so he had, you know, 3 weeks to live and trying to finish these 2 7-hour miniseries. And so he gives this wonderful, very elegant, not sad or remorseful interview, you know, while he's, you know, undergoing this. And he can't even eat food. He's like chain smoking. And whenever the pain gets too much, he has this little thing of opium that he sips just to kind of keep the pain down, but not so much to where he gets messed up.
So, Matt, this is you're in charge of finding. This is going in rotation.
To find the opium? Oh, you mean the video. Okay.
Sorry. You can find it. It's Dennis Potter's final interview. It's really...
Wow, okay.
When I watch that, I'm like, man, I got no problems.
Right.
You know? This guy could do this. You know?
Things are
And he
all
did
right.
it. He finished.
Wow. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, so Dennis Potter was a big influence on me. And a lot of old films. One of my favorites, The Ghost and Mrs. Muir. Have you seen that with Rex Harrison and Gene Tierney? That was something that influenced my love of black and white and how you can get away with very little. You know, like the special effects in that is somebody lights a candle and there's a guy standing in the shadow who's a ghost. You know,
right.
It's very simple. There's this very elegant shot at the beginning, which I think is kind of a masterpiece when you first see the ghost's silhouette. It's beautiful, beautiful film. But yeah, I got a lot of different influences, musically. Right now, my influences are people who are collaborating on this project.
And himself, according to what we were listening to earlier.
Yeah, I steal from myself all the time. So I don't know if it's stealing if you already have it in your hand.
Didn't John Fogerty have to go to the Supreme Court over that?
He did.
Sometimes it is.
Yeah. So how do you like, I mean, obviously you enjoy the crowdsourcing, but compared to the more traditional way of doing it, what are some of the pros and cons?
Well, the way I made Stingray Sam and the American Astronaut was storyboard everything to the teeth. You know, like everything was storyboarded, the camera movements.
And it was very clear, at least I thought too, that like, so a lot of those shots, you could take still images and make a graphic novel out of those. And I mean, it was very clearly planned visually up front.
Yeah, there was a lot of preconceived ideas by the time you hit the set. When I made Crazy and Thief, I just knew what I was aiming for. But again, I had a 7-year-old and a 2-year-old as my leads. And they did it. They did what they were asked to do, and they did it beautifully, and they did it very organically. This, I'm surprised by what people contribute. It's pleasantly surprised. There was a gentleman in Fort Collins who wanted me to come out, and he was kind of by himself up there. Him and this other guy put together the show. There was about 20 people showed up for the show. It was extremely enthusiastic, and he filmed it, and he gave me the footage, and it's some of the coolest footage I think I've ever seen in my life. He was playing the focus like somebody playing jazz, you know, and it was really amazing. And I was like, God, this guy's a genius, you know? So this goes into the film, and then you know, it's so different. There was 5 cameras in Iceland, and each one of them very distinct looking, and each one of them just, I mean, they were really talented people. Also, the graphic work that people send me, the illustrations for Small Star Seminar, amazing. And people have shown up, and these 2 gentlemen in Denver brought these prints, and I just bring them with me everywhere and put them up at venues so that there's a consistency through the sets.
Mm-hmm. So very nice.
Yeah.
And I guess it allows you to kind of go into areas you wouldn't normally be if you were, I mean, everybody has their own style. So being able to pull from other people's styles allows you to kind of go and different directions you'd probably allow yourself to go if it were just you creating it.
Yeah, and there's also, I mean, there's an element too with, I made a video for a friend of mine where I had this little flip camera which didn't do well in low light, and it was in a nightclub. It's called That One Guy. Maybe you can find it on YouTube.
The percussionist?
No, he plays it. Well, it does play percussion, but he has it's this pipe.
Yeah. And he plays the boot as well.
Yeah, it's got strings on it.
What are you talking about?
Yeah. He plays the percussion with his feet. I did a video for him because we were on tour together. And so I just always filmed this one song that he played. And when I got home, individually, every single shot looked terrible. You know, but you cut them together and you put them together and like the worst piece of footage you have looks golden. He's like, oh, I love that shot. I'm like, you wouldn't if you saw it by itself.
Right.
Not a standalone piece.
Yeah, so there's also that, like, you know, different varying degrees of you know, quality still is going to work in this project.
That's just utterly fascinating. We don't, I can't even imagine when I would get a chance to do something like that.
Well, you can tonight. Just come.
Well, that's true. And again, I guess we should reiterate that you're performing tonight at the Texas Theater Behind the Screen. It's a musical performance, as well as, are you going to be speaking?
Yeah, it's mostly a concert.
Okay.
I'm going to do a Q&A afterwards, and I might talk a bit about deep astronomy and things like that in between a couple of songs. But it's and deep astronomy, it's pretty fun. It's a fascinating, fascinating topic. And the further I get into it, and also my conversations with Ferguson, the more it keeps expanding, and it also expands this project, and it filters into the performances, and it helps inform this feature film project that we're making.
Well, speaking of live music, I had Matt go out and purchase me some materials from Home Depot, and while we were shooting this, I've been underneath the desk building a ukulele, which I've passed to you under the desk.
I know, I didn't know what that was.
Very creepy hands.
Somebody's got a curious puppy down there.
And I was wondering, would you grace us with one of those, it's like music but words to song. Could you? Yes. Perfect.
This is beautiful what you've made here.
Thank you very much. Threw it together. Oh, that old thing.
It's larger than mine.
Oh, thank you. I wish more ladies would admit that. It's also weird that girls that I'm dating would know what your size is, but let's move on to the next segment.
The girls you're dating, what? well, this is a really old song of mine. I wrote it a long, long time ago. I don't even know if you'd call it a song. It's more of a story. But this is an oldie, a classic.
I like this one.
That's all I'm going to do. There was a garden, and there was a tree, and there were three of me. I was a snake and a crow and a cat, and in the tree all three of me sat for eternity. And that was that. One night, an apple grew. And the apple knew everything that I knew. It was part of me, and it was part of the tree that I climbed into and flew into and slithered to, and now I grew. And there I sat, as an apple and a snake and a crow and a cat. And that was pretty much that until one day, a girl who was not me came out to play. And I could see what she wanted from me. She wanted to know what the apple knew. And I said, you already do, my dear. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. And she said, please. I've come to eat the apples from the trees. And I said, no. I am an apple and a snake and a cat and a crow. And she said, please. I need to have that apple inside of me. She wanted to know everything I knew. And I said, but my dear, you already do. Then she stamped her foot and said, for heaven's sake, why can't you be a cat and a crow and a snake? And I said, no. Let the apple go. Then she took a bite. And I could tell that she knew I was right. She walked away weeping with the apple in her hand,
and fed my secrets to another man. So I slid away and flew away, and out of the tree I ran. I who was once one, now forever three. A cat and a crow and a snake without a tree. Just a snake and a crow and a cat, and that was that.
Yeah. That's one of my favorites.
Thank you.
And I was that one's is that Caesar and Barry, the one you were playing a little earlier?
Yeah, part of that.
That's I gotta admit that when that kicks in, that's one of my favorite parts in all of rock history. With that,
because
I was
rock and roll.
So not expecting that, and it hits, and it's a little bit on the upbeat too. Like it doesn't hit when you think it's going to, and I always really enjoy.
Here's one of my oldest songs.
Okay, yeah, okay. Absolutely.
That's it. You made a brand new pot of soup for me. You said to put it away. I forgot to refrigerate the pot, and so it rotted by the very next day. And you said that was how I am, and how I don't care about anything but me. And you said to change the cap box, and I didn't change the cap box. And I said I changed the cap box, and I didn't change the cap box. And you said that was how I am, and how I don't care about anything but me.
I have not heard that one before.
That's ancient. I wrote that before I wrote songs.
Oh man, that is going up on the inner tubes. That is fantastic. No, I've never heard that.
It's
and I thought I owned just about
soup pot.
Well, Corey, it's been absolutely fantastic having you in today. We're coming up on the close of the hour, so everybody at home, make sure.
But I have so much to tell you.
Oh, you're coming back.
I have so much to tell you.
Oh, next time you're in town, you're definitely right. Stopping. Or we'll make a trip to Austin to visit you. But again, you're doing Texas Theater Night. It's mainly a concert. You're going to be doing a little Q&A afterwards.
Yeah, Texas Theater.
Texas Theater on
Oak Cliff.
What time
is that?
8 o'clock, right?
8 o'clock.
8 p.m., correct.
8 p.m. And he's just angry. But the 8 p.m., I'll be doing the Small Star Seminar, and you can listen to the music. You can preview the music for tonight's performance at CoreyMaccabee.net. Hit me back with a net.
Net.
CoreyMaccabee.net. Or SmallStarSeminar.net. Or SmallStarCorp.net. But you can listen to there's a Bandcamp link there. You can buy it. You can get it on iTunes or Amazon, or you can listen to it for free at CoreyMaccabee.net. And hopefully you'll like it. I think, like I say, I'm so proud of this record, and I think it's possibly my favorite thing.
Well, if the one song we heard today was any indication, I'm all on board for this.
Yeah, so good.
Now, we get to end today on a little segment we normally do called What's in the Box? It is not Gwyneth Paltrow's head. We'll start right off that for any movie aficionados.
Does she have a tiny head?
No, the movie 7, they cut it off. And every time we do it, normally everybody quotes that movie. And I don't because I don't want to get sued.
She may also have a tiny head, too.
She may also have a tiny head, for all I know.
That would be nice. Mm-hmm.
So, the goal here, you're going to compete against Brian today.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to try to guess what's in the box. I give you two or three hints. You get two questions and then a guess. So,
what is in the box?
You can't ask that question. Oh. That's too easy.
No, I'm thinking. I can't believe I said that. I thought I was thinking.
Question time. Yeah. Let's see. Gosh, this is a representative form of something else. It's an indexical representation, and you can't help him.
He's using $5 words. He can use $5 words.
That was what they taught us in college, and I can use it. Let's see. This is also a. It's to be enjoyed in a different fashion than how it's presented here. All right, so who would like to go first on questions?
Is it a meatloaf sandwich?
No, it is not a meatloaf sandwich.
Does that count as one of my guesses?
That is one of your guesses. You should have asked questions beforehand to clarify. Now, I'm afraid, I'm sorry, it goes to Corey. Two questions to clarify, one question to guess.
It's something meant to be enjoyed outside of a box.
Well, yes, first of all that. But one of the item itself is not what you enjoy. It's how that item is used.
La la.
All I can think is it's a finger, but I'm sure.
They're all here.
And I'm asking a question, not not guessing yet.
Gotcha. Okay.
Oh, is that
yes.
Okay?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. Is it edible?
I would say, I guess you could if you really wanted to, but it's not supposed to be. Okay, if you really wanted to force this down, you could.
Okay, see, I'm going like finger booger. let's see. Is it... does it work with a computer?
Not this particular format, but other formats that do what this does do work with computers. Mm-hmm. And I take that back. The new versions of these do work with computers. I take that back.
Oh.
The old ones would not have.
Is there music involved?
Yes, there is music involved.
I thought he just got two questions. Okay,
Brian, we got competitive in here.
Do you have a guess?
I took one of you. You didn't ask me, so I thought I had a lot to do with.
He got four of them for that. Yeah.
I'm thinking it's some kind of I'm thinking a hard drive or an iPod.
And very interesting. Very interesting. It is a type of recording format. Brian, would you like to?
Is it a Zoom player?
It is not a Zoom player. I would not be giving away a Zoom player. Yeah.
You guys aren't that poor, right?
No.
Can you store things on it?
Yes, it is a storage format.
Storage format.
It is both a format and a physical form. I will give you that hint.
Is it USB based?
No, it is not USB based.
Bullion based.
It's not bullion based either.
It's not a finger. It's not a booger. It's not a hard drive. Yeah.
What shape is it?
What other things are there in this world?
What shape is it?
Hey, you're not playing.
Yeah, what are you doing?
I'm trying to help here.
Okay. Overall, it is a strip. However, each individual unit is about 35 millimeters.
Listerine strips?
No, they're not.
Damn, that was mine. You would put it in a lead box so I can't see it.
Yes, and sometimes you would put these in lead boxes to keep the older versions of these from exploding.
It's a frame from a it's a strip from a 35 millimeter.
Well, correct. It is the trailer for the movie Pearl Harbor. The entire movie trailer that when I worked at a theater, I don't know why, because I don't like the movie at all. In fact, I think that's the reason I took it. I have a Lord of the Rings one, that one I'm keeping. But Pearl Harbor, here you go, Corey.
Thank you very much.
Anytime you feel like going into a movie theater and asking to hook that up, you can now watch the trailer from the movie Pearl Harbor.
What year? What year is this film?
What? 2002?
Yeah, 2002.
Something like that, yeah.
This is a luxury that most people don't have. Thank you so much.
No problem. Wow. Well, I'm glad somebody finally got that one. I was really unsure if that one was going to happen. Well, it's happened again. We've stumbled upon the end of the show. So we are going to go out to, I believe we have, this is one of Brian's and I's favorite again, Silver Miners, which is just... Again, there's sometimes I couldn't have, if you'd paused this movie at any point and said, what's coming next? Zero chance I ever would have guessed what the next scene was. And now I can't imagine in a world where this isn't a thing.
No, trailer for Pearl Harbor.
It's all non sequiturs. But I should say one more time, make sure you go down tonight to the Texas Theater in Oak Cliff, behind the screen, that you're supposed to be there. It's not like we're just hanging out, smoking doobies behind there. We are all supposed to be there. But Corey McAbee is going to be playing a show tonight. I can't think of a better artist if you've never seen or heard him. I don't know how, because you just literally watched an hour of him performing here his music. I can say I highly, highly recommend people coming out to see you. It's just... You're one of my favorites.
Thank you.
That's all I can say.
Yeah, come on down and we'll take selfies, everybody. It's a lot of fun.
And on that note, let's go out on from the American Astronaut, Silver Miners. Once again, Corey McAbee, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
So
you,
much. Thank Brian, you. Thanks for calling in. He called in dead to work today, so he's going to have to think of a really good excuse for being reanimated tomorrow.
You're probably watching this.
That's it.
Exactly.
Found him.
So I took today off work, too. I went in for 2 full hours, and then I booked it out of there as soon as I could. So here we go. But once again, thank you so much. Make sure you come out to the Texas Theater, 8 p.m. tonight. It's going to be great. Matt and I will be down there. Don't let that be a reason to scare you off.
Yeah. Still come.
Corey's music is going to be utterly fantastic. You can check out more at CoreyMcAbee.net.
Net.
And one more time, give out some of the other websites.
Or SmallStarSeminar.net. Go to SmallStarSeminar.net.
Net.
Or SmallStarCorp.net.
Net. Excellent. This is a bit I'm going to keep going for the rest of every time we do an episode from now on. So, all right. Well, I'm going to keep saying thank you if I don't just end the show.
Thank you.
Once again, so great for coming in. Now I have my own recording of two Corey McAbee songs that no one else has. And yeah. They are mine. And I told him I'm probably going to cut that out of the episode before we put it up so that no one else can hear them but me.
Ah.
And I will lock them in a safe. So one more time, thank you again. 8 o'clock at the Texas Theater. This has been Fun Time Good Show on Deep Ellum On Air along with One Eye Joe Media. I've been your host, Corey McAbee. And I want to say thank you to my guest, Del Pullen, for coming on today. It's a real pleasure. Oh, feel free to play music over this.
What is that? What are we looking at?
This is the...
The Silver Miners.
And the Silver Miners. Oh, here we go.
Is it?
Humping on each other every chance we could. Hell, sometimes some of us good old boys would even be humping on each other. And it weren't like we were trying to be fancy. We just didn't know what the hell we were looking at, did we, John?
Yeah, we did.
So, one day I dug up this rock, and it was a brand new color. Not a trace or hint or nothing of any other color you ever seen. It looked like memories, and, well, it was embarrassing. And if you looked at it, all the parts of your brain that just sat there doing nothing would start right up. And you knew what they were there for. So we looked at it and it turned us real smart. The next day we went into town and read all there was to read about the chart. Then we went out into the desert, built us this big barn and sent it up here into space with us in it. Been here ever since. Now the one thing we didn't reckon on was space punies.
We're space punies.
Hey, Jake, what are space punies?
In a world without gravity, the muscles will become dormant and wither. Your spine will straighten and the calcium in your arms and legs will redistribute itself in your head.
Thank you, Jake. See, old Jake knows. Hey, Jake, what happens if you go back to Earth with space punies?
It kills you slicker than snot.
And now, we gotta get back there, because every day they're making further discoveries about the chart. In an attempt to further our knowledge, Jake and Edna started humping on each other, and lo and behold, a child was born among us. Had we known he'd have grown up to be such a hellion, we'd have killed him on that day. Instead, we raised him on coffee, tobacco, candy bars, kind of stuff our guts couldn't take. We built him a suit of hydraulics so his muscles would grow strong as he was raised to stand up against Earth's gravity as he set out to gain more knowledge on behalf of his kin. A journey the boy don't know nothing about on account of him being as dumb as a stick.